Gravitation is not responsible for people falling in love. Albert Einstein. They were smashing a proton into an atom, and so these things were called atom smashers. I don't think physicists really like the word very much. It's not all that descriptive. First of all, you are not really smashing the atom. You are really just adding energy to our nucleus, creating a particle and seeing what comes out. You might argue that what physicists are doing is, you know, I hand you a beautiful Swiss watch and I say, figure out how these things work. So you look at it, for a second, and then you smash it against the wall, and you look at the gears that come flying out, and you say, okay, I know it's made of the gears, give me another one. That's sort of the idea here. You are trying to figure out what is inside of the proton and the neutrons. What kind of fundamental particles are there by smashing things together, getting lots of energy and looking to see what comes flying out. At the same time, the particle accelerator was developing, the particle detector was improving. Think back to the early 1900s when Mr. Rutherford had two graduate students, actually one of them was an undergraduate, sitting in front of the little piece of a phosphorescent screen in the dark, counting flashes with their eyes, very painful work. Later, the cloud chamber was developed, and then in the early 1950s, the bubble chamber, which is denser because it's a liquid, particle goes through this very hot liquid, and as a charged particle goes through, leaving a little ion trail, it also creates a bunch of little bubbles because this liquid is super heated. It really wants to boil, and the little charged particle leave a track where it can more easily boil. You take a picture and you see an image of the tracks of the particles. If they happen to hit the nucleus, you will see all the spray that comes out, and you can begin to identify all the particles that come out. You look for the density of the dots, which teaches you about the energy and charges of the particle. You stick it in the big magnetic field so that the tracks are curved, and you can learn about the energy and momentum. You can identify particles and learn about their properties, which of course is really what you want to do. If you want to understand new particles, particles are like a pion. You want to know its mass, you want to know its charge, you want to know its spin, you want to know everything there is to know. How long does it live? How long is the dark before it decays in turn? The energy is increased. By the 1950s, Berkeley had what they called the Bibatron. The Bibatron was a super cyclotron which reaches the energy of the billion of electron volts in the metric conventions that would be called giga electron volt. A giga metric prefix for billion. Billion, yes. So a giga is like a gigabyte in your computer. That's a billion units of memory, and a billion electron volt is a lot. In fact, the Bibatron could reach 6 gigabillion volts. And how much energy is that? Well, a proton has a less mass energy of the approximately 1 billion electron volts, so 6 is more than enough to produce a proton and an antiproton. Mr. Dirac, back in the 1920s, had an equation that predicted that every particle should have an antiparticle, and we had discovered anti-electrons early on, naturally in the cosmic rays, because electrons are so light. It doesn't take so much energy to make an electron-anti-electron pair. To make an antiproton requires a billion of electron volts, and this facility was actually designed specifically to have enough energy to do that. And sure enough, the antiproton was there, right where you expected it to be. The bubble chamber invention in 1952 really improved our ability to look at high energy particles because of the high density of the liquid. The higher the density, the more likely it is that you'll see the some interactions. There are more opportunities for the high energy particles that is cruising through to interact. The story goes, by the way, that the bubble chamber was invented by a physicist named Glaser, who was sitting in the bar, looking at his beer glass, watching the bubbles rising and sort of thinking about what was making those bubbles from. This gave him his inspiration for the bubble chamber. It's kind of a nice idea for future physics research. As people built higher and higher energy machines and better detectors, the need for automating the detection process grew. Computers weren't really in big use at that early stage, but they quickly came into use. For example, instead of using a bubble chamber, where one needs to take a picture and develop, and it then make measurements with a ruler to look at the image and try to categorize what particles he has seen. We now have devices where it's all completely automated. Instead of the bubble chamber, we have a device with wires and a charged particle goes through, producing a little track. The little ions will drift over in the drift chamber to those wires. Then there will be an electrical signal which can be fed into computer. Essentially, the process became more automated, but fundamentally was still the same thing that was happening. It's just a little bit more sophisticated, and human beings aren't directly involved in the interpretation at the first stages. So, as we are discovering new particles, and we immediately started to discover new particles, not only ones that we were expecting, Mr. Yukawa's pion and antipions were the two that we expected, but we started finding new particles. Now the naming the convention was Greek letters, so there was a delta particle, the rho, and the omega. There were first tens, then dozens, and later hundreds of the new particles being discovered. Really? Sort of an explosion of the information and the factual data. At first, there was no organizing particle. At first, there was no organizing principle. It was kind of an exciting time, but also a little bit overwhelming. There were all these new particles, so what do you do? Well, you carefully measure their electric charge, their mass, their lifetime, their spin, and their angular momentum. You try to characterize each particle. You try to characterize how strongly it interacts, and you discover that almost all the particles we are talking about here interact very strongly, just as the proton and the neutrons interact very strongly. The pion, the carrier of the strong force, interacts very strongly. When I say interacts very strongly, the remember what that means in the quantum mechanics. It means there is a high probability of the interaction. If you send a pion into chamber, it's going to interact just right away, and it's going to produce other particles. They are going to interact right away, and if they decay, they are going to decay right away. So these strong interacting particles tend to be radioactive, which means by decade, they turned into the other particles very quickly. these particles have very, very short lifetimes. These strong interactions leading to a short lifetime allow us to classify all of these particles as strongly interacting, so people started coming up with a nomenclature. Now, I don't want to burden you with a nomenclature, and it's not so important, but it's useful when you are talking about the developing story to at least have a little bit of a framework of the words to use to describe different categories of the particles. It's like when I go for a walk in the woods, I can't identify very many trees, but at least I can say there are deciduous and these are coniferous. It's nice to have some words, just so that I can separate in my mind these different categories of trees. Yes, indeed. For example, we are going to describe particles as either strongly interacting or not. Strongly interacting particles will be called hadrons, from the Greek word hadros, which means heavy or thick. Actually, not heavy, but thick. Hadron is any particle, a proton, a neutron, a pion, anything that is being produced in these particles accelerators that interact strongly. The flip side is that you are either a hadron or you are a lepton. A lepton comes from the Greek word leptos, which means light, and that would be like the electron, the neutron, neutrino, or the muon. Those particles do not interact strongly. They tend to just go right on through. For instance, your bubble chamber, leaving a little track behind it if it's an electron or muon, because they are electrically charged but not really doing much. These are very rare interactions with the nucleus. So you've got the hadrons and leptons. Now, as we study the hadrons, that's mostly what people were studying in the late 40s through the 50s and onwards. That's what the particle accelerator were really focusing on. You begin to subcategorize those strongly interacting particles, and there were two big categories, two main categories of hadrons. You are either a baryon or a meson. Every particle that's found is either a hadron or a meson. If it's strongly interacting, what's the difference? The baryon are kind of what I think of other particles. Baryon, from Greek word baryos, is heavy. Like the proton and the neutron, it's really a particle. If you measure its spin, it had a spin 1/2. Spin 1/2 is very characteristic of anything that you think of that particle as the object that makes up makes up other objects. They are the baryons. The meson was like Mr. Yukawa's particle. Remember, Mr. Yukawa invented this intermediary. It was called a meson. Mesos for in the middle. It was middle in the mass. It was in between the protons and the neutrons. It was a different nature. When Mr. Yukawa proposed it, it was like a force carrier, not a particle, but the force carrier between the particles. It's still a particle, and so as we begin to discover more and more mesons, it becomes a little bit difficult to just think of them as force carriers. We don't think of them that way at all anymore. That's sort of an old 1930s idea which helped us to develop our more modern ideas that we are going to learn about in the future. So what characterizes a meson? Well, the first one that were discovered were intermediate in the weight. At first, they tended to be lighter than the proton and neutrons. The pion, for example, has spin 0. It doesn't spin. It has no angular degree of freedom. You have a pion. It's just there. It has the electric charge, it might be positive, negative or zero, but it's not rotating in any sense. It has no spin degree of freedom. It's a fancy way of saying that. And you can produce a pion like crazy. There are no conservation laws for pions. Remember, I said if you create a proton, you are going to have to create an antiproton. You can't just create a positive electric charge out of nowhere. You have to create proton and antiproton pairs together. But you can just make a single pion, especially if it has to be a neutral pion, because you can't produce electric charge. Pions just as in making photons, if you jiggle an electric charge. Pion just as in the making photons, if you jiggle an electric charge, it produces the light. What's light? It's just a bunch of photons flying off. What's light? It's just a bunch of photons flying off. You can produce as many protons, as many photons as you like. There is no conservation law for them. There is no conservation laws for them. So mesons are these particles that are kind of like photons, except they are real. They are massive. They have a charge. They are kind of like heavy version of the pion. Now, let's think a little bit more about what I'm saying. A heavy version of a particle. So you have the proton and the neutron. Those are the simplest, lightest baryons. But then you've got these new particles that are being discovered, and they have names such as delta and lambda and sigma. Right, all these Greek letters. What's a delta? Well, in a certain sense, you can think of it as a big, heavy proton. If you produce one, it will just fall apart fairly quickly. It's a radioactive, and it will turn into the proton and some other stuff. Some pions, for example, might go flying out to carry away the extra energy. So you have heavy versions making a kind of tower of more and more and more particles that are all baryons. Then you have the pion, which is the lightest kind of meson, and you have this tower of more and more and more other kinds of mesons, which themselves decay, usually into lighter mesons, and then ultimately into the electrons and neutrinos and so on. Yeah. So this was a story that was developing in the 1950s. We were beginning to collect data, information, and it was pretty overwhelming. And the people didn't quite know what to make of it. Think of the situation 100 years earlier in the 1800s. People, chemists were the big players back then, were collecting data on all elements. Hydrogen, helium, carbon, and nitrogen, but they were just collecting data. What was the mass? And what were the chemical properties? It's kind of an analogous story, and at first, the chemists didn't realize that there was the pattern to it. In the late 1800s, Mendeleev discovered that the chemical elements actually fit into a beautiful periodic table. They were ordered because atoms are really simple things. They are built up of the protons and the neutrons, with electrons flying around them. There is a picture that we have nowadays that simplifies our understanding of those maybe 100 odd elements that were being discovered. So in the 1950s, people were hunting for something similar. They were looking for a new periodic table to organize this zoo of the particle, so that life wouldn't be so complicated. And it's a little bit frustrating to think that these particles, they seem to be fundamental particles, and there are so many of them. I mean, it could be that nature's just complicated. We don't know. Maybe nature just has 100 or 200 fundamental particles. Now, you might say to me, well, I think the protons and neutrons are fundamental, and these new ones, like the delta, the lambda, and all those are radioactive. They are not really fundamental, and I would argue there is not really much of a difference. One particle can transform into another. A neutron can transform into a proton. A proton can transform into a neutron. They all, in a certain sense, are equally valid, equally fundamental particles. There is no real way that you can say this one is less fundamental than that. They are just all there. They really do exist in nature, although most of the time you don't see their particles in the cosmic rays. Every now and again you do, but you usually don't have enough energy in the cosmic rays, so mostly these are artificial creations. But they are still fundamental particles. We've created artificial radioactive elements such as plutonium. Plutonium. And they are real. You could argue that we've created them. They not usually present in nature. Nonetheless, I would argue that they are elements like any other elements, right? Moreover, human being itself is in the nature. So invention of the nature, invented by nature. So human being made it artificially, meaning nature make it naturally, right? Yes. So we've got this big zoo of particles, and in the next lecture I'm going to talk about the first attempts by theorists to try to organize this story. Ultimately, we are going to discover that the story is really very simple. Nature is at its core beautiful and simple, and all these two can be understood. Once again, in terms of just three fundamental underlying particles, it took another 10 years for people to figure that out, so that's where we are headed, down into the substructure of these fundamental particles. Right, thank you.